morning. Please join me in our call to worship. Will you, God, live on this small planet Earth? Look, heaven and earth cannot contain you, much less this house of prayer which we have built and shared.
There is a stone, and you shall find me. We would, and I am there.
There is no God like you, God of Jesus, neither on earth nor elsewhere in the whole universe.
If I God who keeps every promise and shows us where we go, preserve us in all the waters of all the ways.
Blessed are you, our Creator and Redeemer. Come, let us worship God.
Let us pray. God of life and love, as we turn to you, you have already turned to us and called on us, my people, my beloved. We are restored when we wait before you and meditate on you. We are reawakened with hope to be reminded again that you are the living God. So we gather with you in your presence, and we offer you our love and thanks for keeping the world turning, for infusing all that exists with the breath of your Spirit, for looking on us with warmth and pride because we are yours. We pray in the names of your community of love, Source, Savior, Sustainer. Amen. And friends, now may the peace of Christ be with you.
Our first lesson is from 1 Kings chapter 8, page 271 in your pew Bibles. Then Solomon assembled the elders of Israel and all the heads of the tribes, the leaders of the ancestral houses of the Israelites, before King Solomon in Jerusalem, to bring up the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord out of the city of David, which is Zion. Then the priest brought the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord to its place in the inner sanctuary of the house, in the most holy place, underneath the wings of the cherubim. And when the priests came out of the holy place, a cloud filled the house of the Lord, so that the priests could not stand to minister because of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord filled the house of the Lord. Then Solomon stood before the altar of the Lord in the presence of all the assembly of Israel, and spread out his hands to heaven. He said, O Lord, God of Israel, there is no God like you in heaven above or on earth beneath, keeping covenant and steadfast love for your servants, who walk before you with all their hearts. The covenant that you kept for your servant, my father David, as you declared to him. You promised with your mouth and have this day fulfilled with your hand. Therefore, O Lord, God of Israel, keep for your servant, my father David, that which you promised him, saying, there shall never fail you a successor before me to sit on the throne of Israel, if only your children look to their way, to walk before me as you have walked before me. Therefore, O God of Israel, let your word be confirmed, which you promised to your servant, my father David. But will God indeed dwell on the earth? Even heaven and the highest heaven cannot contain you, much less this house that I have built. Regard your servant's prayer and his plea, O Lord my God, heeding the cry and the prayer that your servant prays to you today, that your eyes may be opened night and day toward this house, the place of which you said, my name shall be there, that you may heed the prayer that your servant prays toward this place. Hear the plea of your servant and of your people Israel when they pray toward this place. Oh, here in heaven your dwelling place, heed and forgive. Likewise, when a foreigner, who is not of your people Israel, comes from a distant land because of your name, for they shall hear of your great name, your mighty hand, and your outstretched arm. When a foreigner comes and prays toward this house, then hear in heaven your dwelling place, and do according to all that the foreigner Idaho. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please join me in reciting Psalm 84, which is printed in your bulletins. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. My soul longs and indeed faints for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh sing for joy to the living God. Even the sparrow finds a home, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young at your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. Happy are those who live in your house, ever singing your praise. Happy are those whose strength is in you, in whose heart the highways design, that they may live through the valley of Baca, and make a place of springs. The early rain also covers it with pools. They go from strength to strength. The God of gods will be seen in Zion. O Lord God of hosts, hear my prayer. Give ear, O God of Jacob. Behold our shield, O God. Look upon the face of your anointed. For a day in your courts is better than a thousand elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than live in the tents of wickedness. For the Lord God is a sun and shield. God bestows favor and honor. No good thing does the Lord withhold from those who walk uprightly. For the Lord of hosts, happy is everyone who trusts in you. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our third lesson is from the book of John, chapter 6, verses 56 through 69. Page 868 in your pew Bibles. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate, and they died. But the one who eats this bread will live forever. He said these things while he was teaching in the synagogue at Capernaum. When many of his disciples heard it, they said, "This teaching is difficult. Who can accept it?" But Jesus, being aware that his disciples were complaining about it, said to them, "Does this offend you? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh is useless. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But among you there are some who do not believe. For Jesus knew from the first who were the ones that did not believe, and who was the one that would betray him. And he said, "For this reason, I have told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted by the Father." Because of this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer went about with him. So Jesus asked the 12, "Do you also wish to go away?" Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and know that you are the Holy One of God." This is also the word of the Lord.
And now listen also to God's word as it comes to us in Ephesians, the letter to the Ephesians, chapter 6, verses 10 through 12. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of the Lord's power. Put on the whole armor of God so that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For our struggle is not against enemies of blood and flesh, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this present abyss, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God so that you may be able to withstand on that evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm. Stand therefore and fasten the belt of truth around your waist and put on the breastplate of righteousness. And as shoes for your feet, put on whatever will make you ready to proclaim the gospel of peace. With all of these, take the shield of faith with which you will be able to quench all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Pray in the Spirit all times, in every prayer and supplication. And to that end, keep alert and always persevere in supplication for all the saints. Pray also for me, so that when I speak, a message may be given to me to make known the boldness, the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it boldly, as I must speak. Friends, this too is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Know the bear. If you encounter a bear in the wild and it pursues you, it helps to identify the species. Different bears require different responses. If a black bear charges, you are supposed to become big and loud, clap your hands over your head, and pretend to be intimidating. If a grizzly bear or a brown bear charges, you are supposed to drop to the ground, curl up in a ball, and pretend to be a little piece of nothing that's not worth the time of a mighty beast. Know the bear. If it is brown, lay down. If it is black, fight back. The Christians in Ephesus realized that it was helpful to identify their adversary. They were a minority people who appeared to be under attack by the established religious leaders and the powers of Rome, and oftentimes they were misunderstood and rejected by their very own families. Christians were vulnerable. And the letter to the Ephesians cautions Christians not to mistake human adversaries as being the ultimate threat to their survivals. The humans who Christians encounter are not to be feared. Ominous spiritual forces are the real danger. There is a battle on earth that is between the power of God and the forces of evil. The fight is not one that can be engaged through acts of defensiveness or aggression, for our struggles are not against the enemies of blood and flesh, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of the present abyss, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. And today, we may identify the enemy as white supremacists, neo-Nazis, Taliban, ISIS. But the people who form these groups are bit players. They are nothing more than flesh and blood. A far greater battle against the cosmic powers is being waged against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Christians are to resist the temptation to fight the enemy here on earth. We are to trust that the hosts of heaven will defeat the demonic forces. God will prevail. The forces of evil will be defeated by the power of God. This teaching may be well and good when spelled out in a letter of encouragement to the followers of Christ, but our theology requires an extraordinary faith in real-world situations. It is one thing to have a plan for an encounter with a bear, and it is quite another to have to use it. When a bear is charging, it is a challenge to be big and loud or small and insignificant. It is daunting to respond as we are taught. When we come face to face with adversaries on earth, Christians desire a specific, viable plan, even if the battle is emblematic of a spiritual warfare that is waged in heaven. Blood clouds reasoning. Fear prompts panic. The letter to the Ephesians provides a strategy for these frightening moments. We are told to put on the whole armor of God so that we may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. The strategy is to stand. The strategy is to stand. We are to stand fast. This is from the Greek word, histemi. The word is used three times in this one passage. Stand against the wiles of the devil. Stand firm. Stand, therefore, and fasten the belt of truth around your waist. Stand, stand, stand. Notice the absence of aggression, and notice the action. To stand does not mean to do nothing. Standing is a response. If one encounters a bear in the wild, standing is a measured reaction. And so it is with evil in the world. We stand fast. Verse 13 has an added dimension. We are to both withstand and stand. Take up the whole armor of God so that you may be able to withstand on that evil day. And having done everything to stand firm. Et histemi is the Greek word for withstand. Christians withstand evil to be able to stand firm. And consider how on this very day when Hurricane Henry, when the hurricane sweeps through the Hudson Valley, we will withstand the forces of its wind and an illusion rain while we stand against it and survive. And so it is with evil. We withstand the power of evil and we stand firm. Christians are not asked to stand unprotected. We are given a suit of armor, the armor of God. The problem is that there are times when the armor of God seems woefully insufficient for the battles we endure. We have demonstrated a preference for armament that may be used aggressively against our enemies, rather than standing around like Pollyanna pacifists waiting for divine intervention. Weapons of war seduce us into thinking that we have the power to fight God's battles. We can do it. We can take care of it for you, God. Susan Shuren asks us to evaluate how our choices have served us. Susan is a citizen in San Diego that wrote a letter to the editor of a newspaper regarding the humanitarian crisis in Afghanistan. Susan Shuren writes, "We should have learned from the French in Vietnam, but we didn't. We should have learned from the Russians in Afghanistan, but we didn't. The Vietnam generation took us into Afghanistan convinced that this time it was different. And the scale of the tragedy is simply devastating. This time, can we get the lesson straight? Military solutions don't fix political and societal problems. The early Christians received the message to refrain from military engagement, and they embraced that teaching. It was an option that was on the table. Remember the word zealot. That comes from a religious sect who were guerrillas. In the time of Jesus, they wanted to bring Jesus into their particular sect and have him fight the Romans, fight alongside them, to lead them in military battle, but Jesus refused. The Jesus movement was peaceful. The followers of Christ were unarmed, even though they were engaged with hostile forces. Sarah Henrich, a professor at Luther Seminary, reminds us that the armor of faith was a wardrobe for survival, not a uniform for war. The armor to be worn by Christians is part of a survival strategy for underdogs. The early Christians were a minority group with no power in the traditional understanding of that word. Hostile forces came after them. Christians were not the aggressors. And when Christianity became a dominant religion, that did not give license to throw out its teachings. We are to continue to stand against the wiles of the devil, withstand evil, and stand firm. Allegiance to Christ requires a belief that peace is paramount. And may we dare to believe that the armor of God is sufficient. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to withstand all on that evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm. Stand, therefore, and fasten the belt of truth around your waist, and put on the breastplate of righteousness. As shoes for your feet, put on whatever will make you ready to proclaim the gospel of peace. And with all of these, take the shield of faith with which you will be able to quench all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. The peace of Christ, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let us pray. How lovely, Lord, how lovely is this place in which we live. You created the hills, the mountains, the river, the valley, all of which is what we call home. We thank you, O Lord, for what has been, for many of us, a good summer. We have enjoyed encountering each other face to face, getting out of our homes, planting gardens, reaping fruits and vegetables, enjoying the splendor of flowers. We give you thanks, O God, that for many of us, home and life is relatively unencumbered. And yet you have given us hearts of compassion and eyes that see. And so we pray for God, pray to you, God, for those who are in need of your healing mercy and your resurrection power. We pray for the people of Haiti, whose homes have fallen in rubble to the ground. Comfort your people as their churches, too, no longer stand. We pray that food and water and safety be heaped upon the people in abundance. We pray for the people of Mexico who have endured one of the worst hurricanes ever. As we pray for those in our region who will sustain damage and a few souls who will be lost, We know, O God, that the scale of suffering there is ever so great and difficult to mend. We pray, O God, for the people who are trying to flee for their lives out of Afghanistan, who want to be lifted from the future that seems in peril. We pray, O God, that as people are lifted away from the danger there, we pray, O God, for a place for planes to land and people to be integrated into new homes and what is for them foreign societies. We need you, God. We need you to prevail. We'll try to do our part, but we need your love and your peace here and now. We offer these prayers to the one your Son taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Now may the Lord bless you.